Thank you very much, Dot, and also can I acknowledge Marion here as well, and John as the Vice Chair of the Chamber as well. Look, it's my great pleasure to be here. I mean, coming to Nelson is such a burden coming from Wellington. When you arrive here, you see the sea, you see the mountains, the day is always fine, and you think, if I could just get back to Wellington now, I mean, it would be just that much nicer. Actually, never. It's a bit of a tear to go back, believe me, back to Wellington after being here. So it's great to be here. I've visited here a number of times over the past couple of years as my role as at that time of science and innovation. I was the spokesperson for science and innovation, and there was some very, very exciting stuff going on here, and I see it's still continuing, just talking to some of the people around here today. I'd like to start today's discussion with a question. Are you familiar with the expression shadow yacht? I wasn't until I saw it in an article in a magazine not long after the global financial crisis began. A shadow yacht is a trailer yacht for your mega yacht. Like a floating garage that you use to carry along your collection of helicopters, cars, motorcycles, jet skis, motorboats. And the point of the article that I was reading was that examples of indulgence like this might not survive the global meltdown. It also described a typical home for the super wealthy in Connecticut. 8 bedrooms, a gym, a theatre, a wine cellar, staff quarters, of course, games room, a Turkish bath, and a special room in the basement for grooming your dogs. And above all, 26 toilets. That's what they have in Connecticut. Now, the year that article was written, 1% of Americans owned 47% of the wealth in that country. We might not have that vast wealth of America, but if you look around, you'd have to say New Zealand is beginning to be perhaps remade in that image. Some people might see that as a triumph of prosperity. I see it as a sign of failure. A small number who prosper and the vast majority who don't. And I don't want New Zealand to keep continuing in this direction. I want us to become a prosperous nation together and to give everyone a fair share. New Zealand's got, and you know here in Nelson, enormous potential as a nation, that we can really be a place where anybody can grow up, be hopeful about the future, and be able to know that the dream that they dream of is within their grasp. Last month, I gave a series of speeches, that I'll be making about New Zealand's future. And I said I intend to lead a government that creates what I'm calling a new New Zealand. I'll be setting out how we get there step by step. And I talked about the need, in that speech, the need to lift our educational achievement and the importance of science and innovation in creating more exports. Today I want to talk about to New Zealanders about who are doing the work, perhaps not reaping the rewards, however. Here in New Zealand, we have been working harder than almost anyone else in the developed world. And it's not paying off. We're trying to succeed by squeezing more out of people by paying lower wages than other countries and working longer hours than them. When people tell me they're actually working harder for less, and they do often, then I believe them. Hundreds of thousands of individuals get out of bed each day, they go to work, they just don't feel they can get ahead. You take the rest home carers who are earning 11 cents an hour above the minimum wage, doing a really important job, which is looking after our parents in their elderly years. They're playing by the rules, they're doing their bit, but how do you raise a family on 11 cents more than the minimum wage? Or take a skilled contractor or the owner of a small business, there might be owners here today who risk everything to raise capital, they need to buy the equipment or a van or take on staff or take on subbies. I want to know that someone is on their side and to feel hopeful that our economy is working just as hard as they are working. Or take a family I know where one parent works as a nurse and the other works in IT. They can manage the mortgage and the groceries, but they're now having to choose between a school trip and a soccer camp. They're not expecting that super yacht, but they do expect to be able to offer their kids real opportunities. When we're working harder than workers in other countries but earning less, and I think we work harder than any other country in the OECD with the exception of Iceland, it's time to change. So let's look at some figures. The average wage in 1989 in today's dollars was about $21.50. By 2011, it had reached around $24.50. If wages had grown at the same rate as productivity for the 22 years up to 2011, then the hourly rate would have been closer to $32. That's an extra $7 an hour, or nearly $300 a week that the average worker earned but actually didn't get paid. Now, I ask you, how many people would be wanting to go to Australia, as they are in record numbers now, if we were paying $300 a week more than what we're paying right now? Surely lifting everyone up must be the point of economic growth, or frankly, why do we bother? That's why we need to create a new economy, a clean, green and clever economy. Now, the government's answer has been for businesses to pay lower wages or push people harder for the same pay or move jobs overseas. It's now making a virtue of our lower wages, calling it, Bill English calls it, New Zealand envy. And he was talking in the Dominion Post yesterday about New Zealand being an attractive place to come and invest in because our wage rates are low. It's as if they want to make New Zealand a truck stop on the way to Mexico. I think there's a more successful path that we should be taking in the 21st century. And when I visit some of the smartest new businesses that go around New Zealand, I see them working cooperatively to get ahead. I've been to dozens and dozens of businesses over the last couple of years, and certainly in the last few months. Almost invariably, I see management and workers intelligently demonstrating good faith on all sides and a recognition that everyone's in there doing their best. Everyone deserves and is deserving of a fair share in the rewards. I was down the other day in Southland and visited TY Point, the aluminium smelter down there. Now, TY Point, nearly 40 years old now, should have been an obsolete aluminium smelter. Probably a couple of decades ago, it should have been obsolete, but it hasn't worked out that way. And that's because management and workers came together and looked at what they had to do to keep the operation running. And through their own sort of effort and ingenuity, and New Zealand's got bucket loads of it, they identified a niche, they got their business going, they scored contracts, and today everybody's sharing in that success. What they did was they targeted the highest quality aluminium, and they make now the highest quality aluminium in the world just by their own ingenuity. They're being well paid. It's an important business in a regional area. You talk to anybody in Bluff or Invercargill about TY's Point and the smelter, and they talk about it with real pride. Higher wages are a feature, not a bug, in our economy. And a message I want to give thousands of New Zealanders who go to work every day, who look after their kids, do the right thing, is this. Labour will deliver for you. Under Labour, you will be our priority. We want the country to work for you. Imagine if we could create a New Zealand where everyone could earn enough to provide a good living for their families. That's not the case now. One emerging idea I'm interested in is the idea of a living wage. It's the amount a person needs to earn to provide for themselves and their family. And it started to catch on in London in 2004 when the London mayor set up a unit that works out what the living wage will be each year. And over time, as finances allowed, the council gradually began to pay the living wage level. Now, some businesses that contract the council have agreed now to pay it as well. Whether they hire direct employees, contractors or temporary staff, they're also paying the living wage. And the results have been hugely encouraging. More than 4 out of 5 employers believe that the living wage enhanced the quality of the work of their staff. Absenteeism fell by a quarter. 2/3 of employers said that recruitment and retention had improved. It was remarkable, the changes. And the attraction of a living wage is it's a voluntary pathway. It's not enforced by law. It's not legally that you have to do this. And it comes in and sets incomes just above the minimum wage. And a lot of businesses, in fact, have found it a good way to show that they're actually good employers, and they've actually put it on their websites and boast about the fact, because it's starting to get that cachet around them. And even some of the big corporates like HSBC, Goldman Sachs, the accountancy firm KPMG, for example, said that they adopted the living wage, and when they adopted the living wage, their staff turnover dropped dramatically. The idea now has cross-party support in the UK. What this living wage recognises is that our workforce is changing. We have to be prepared to look at new ideas. In contrast to that, the government believes that by going cheaper and keeping the minimum wage low, we'll do better. Last month, we had the highest number of people leaving for Australia for better wages. For better wages, that's why they went. And what we're seeing now is our workforce starting to hollow out. You see a small number of high-paying jobs at one end and a growing number of lower-paid jobs at the bottom. And in the middle, where there used to be good pay for doing good work, those jobs are starting to vanish. Even many of the jobs aren't actually permanent either, as many of them are being contracted out and casualised. There's no room for a living wage in a race to the bottom. So as the number of low-paid jobs has grown, the government has stepped in to top them up with payments like working for families. But what we really need is for people to be better paid and for the growth in our economy to filter through to everyone's incomes. We need to imagine an economy where we say, damn it, we can have a country where everyone has enough to live on from their wages. We know the answer to this, and that's to raise productivity. Raising productivity by being smarter. And there's been a lot of talk about this, but it is absolutely and utterly essential. We can't cut our way to prosperity. Zero budgets are what you get when you fail. When you can't grow the economy, you get a zero budget. It's nothing to be proud of. It's nothing to sort of say, we've managed a zero economy. A zero economy means you didn't grow the economy, zero budget means that you didn't grow the economy, so therefore you have to deliver a zero budget. If we don't have enough, and it's clear today we don't, then we also have to be thrifty. But we have to figure out what we need to do to get ahead. A few dozen new businesses that earn well in the international market simply aren't enough. We need to make hundreds of them. And you know well in this chamber that the difference that being made to your economy by high-value added companies that are exporting products built on your region's natural resources. It's great to see Gillian Rapp here, for example, who from Cawthron. I had a visit here a couple of times, I think, to Cawthron. We went out to the Glen to see the mussel farming, what's being done there. Fantastic work being done. It's something you should be talking about much more, because it's basically what we need to be doing right across the whole country. A research institute working with the NMIT, NMIT together with businesses to produce high-value products that are exported. And the example of King Salmon is well working with the Cawthron and with business. That's the sort of thing. Smart businesses that create jobs and create exports. That's the sort of thing that I'm talking about, and you've got it right here in front of you. I think it should be sung about a bit more, actually, if you ask me, and I'll try and do that for you, and then people can come down and actually see it. This government is not doing what's necessary to make that happen around New Zealand, I don't believe. They need to be putting more real firepower behind R&D. They need to be giving the education system the resources it needs to be world class. They need to be getting New Zealanders as excited about innovation as they once were about property speculation. And they're not. And they need most urgently of all to be looking at the ticking time bomb amongst our young people. You know, since 2008, the number of young people out of work has soared. They account for 43% of our total unemployment, a higher share than any other country in the OECD. The number of 15 to 24-year-olds who are not in work, in school, or in training is enough to fill Eden Park. It's in my electorate, that's why I always refer it back to Eden Park. But it's bigger than the area of Nelson in terms of population. 20,000 more joined that statistic over the last 3 years. 20,000 more. This is a disaster for New Zealand. And make no mistake, we'll end up paying very dearly when we have to pick up the pieces down the road. Every young person we lose is also a productive member of the community that we've lost. Young people not in employment, not in education or in training costs us about $1 billion a year. So why wouldn't we invest in them before they become a burden? It makes simple business sense above all. There are not enough jobs or training opportunities. If they all turned up tomorrow asking for a job, there wouldn't be one for all of them. But that's not the whole story. Some of them, as we know, have not much interest in getting one. Some of them are drifting out of school with hardly any qualifications, setting themselves up only for low-paid jobs and low-skilled jobs, and offering temporary jobs. Their future doesn't get much better, and yet in 1 in 5 students has left school by the age of 16. Stuart Middleton, who actually is a leading educationalist in this, and a young man taught me, so he's getting on a bit now as well, as a leading educationist, said, we need to start with those kids leaving secondary school with no qualifications. We need to reach right down into those schools and get those kids before they become a problem. The way it works today is that if you have a classroom of 30 kids and one or two are bored and disruptive, you just want to get them out. That's what the teacher does, and that's what the school does, frankly. These are the ones we have to take a hold of and make sure they go into further education or apprenticeships so that they don't fall through the cracks and end up on the dole and end up doing all the things that we don't want them to do. In Southland, they set up a scheme to track young people after they leave school. They keep in contact with them and they work to get them into training or into jobs. School leavers are not just left to quietly disappear. As many as 10,000 young people are being, called tracked or followed. And the mayor of Clutha says that the program is doing a brilliant job at the top of the cliff rather than at the bottom of the cliff. Got a similar project happening in Otrahonga with the same sort of excellent results. Businesses have relocated to the area because of the support offered to employers and the resource, the actual resource of young trained workers that they can find there. The proportion of youth responsible for resolved crime in Otrahonga dropped from nearly a half down to just a fifth as this scheme was rolled out. So regions are showing real leadership on these schemes. The biggest problem is that only half the country has a youth transition scheme, and instead of supporting these sorts of schemes, we're now hearing that the government's about to cut them. We need to have a comprehensive scheme for the whole country so that none of our kids fall through the cracks. And you know, ultimately, this is self-funding, if there's such a thing. Because instead of a $1 billion drain on our country, these kids will be contributing to it and paying their taxes and becoming worthwhile members of our community, contributing members of our community. So today I'm confirming that it is a Labor priority to get every young person under the age of 20 into skills training, education or employment. That has to be our priority. And the centrepiece of that has to be apprenticeships. Instead of going of paying young people to go on the dole, we should use it to subsidise businesses to take on apprentices. For an employer, and I'm sure many people know here, that it's a risk taking on new staff. Taking on a new trainee can be both a cost, because often the trainees don't produce very much in that first year, but also a risk. The government has to help these companies reduce the risk and provide that opportunity. We're already paying the dole. It's better to pay for it and get some work and get some training done than to have a kid sitting on the dole. Let's give those kids a chance. Let's get the country working. And let's get the country paid properly for doing that work. We don't have to accept the rule that you survive by paying low wages or pushing people harder for the same pay or moving jobs overseas. How you get the economy growing again is you unhook your economy from the practices that get crushed by international competition and move it into the high-value niche areas where you can make a really good living. That's how you get an economy where, as we grow, the real estate agent, the local chemist, the courier driver, the hairdresser, the bank worker, the teacher sees their incomes growing in return for their contribution. As I say, people I meet all around the country say the same thing to me. I work hard, I pay my bills, I'm doing my best at raising my kids and playing my part in the community, and who's going to stand up? And who's going to stand up for me? The answer is that Labour will stand up and back you. When was the last time you heard the government talk about apprentices? When was the last time you heard them ask if everyone is earning enough to live on? When was the last time you heard this government say that their economic plans are for you? The government's plan has more missing in it than it has in it. It consists of selling off bits of New Zealand, our assets, our productive land, watch Crayford Farms tomorrow, doing deals around pokie machines, which is on the news today, and looking after their mates. What we need are big changes. We need a clean, green, clever country where the whole world would like to live. Above all, we need to grow a new economy so that we all share in the benefits. That's the new New Zealand I want to create. If you like the idea of a New Zealand where most people are struggling to get ahead and are happy, few are wondering which of the 26 toilets they're going to use tomorrow, then we don't need to change a thing. But if you think we can do better, well then, let's get going. Thank you very much.